Over to digital currencies, the Philippine Central Bank is optimistic its wholesale digital currency project, dubbed Project Aguila, would lead to a robust national payment system. It's experimenting with its own digital currency for wholesale transactions. Unlike Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies, this one is backed by the country's monetary authority and is less subject to wild swings. The central bank says it will release a sandbox report on Project Aguila by the middle of next year.
We were hoping that with the CBDC, it will make the RTGS even more stable, which will then encourage fintech providers, for example, to be confident that our payment system, the national payment system in general, is robust. And hopefully that will create products that will then improve speed and reliability. So it's going to be a catalyst.
The Philippines plans to raise at least 10 billion pesos at its first ever tokenized treasury bond sale next week, joining other Asian economies in harnessing the power of blockchain technology. The Treasury Bureau will offer one-year peso-denominated tokenized T-bonds on Monday, November 20th, with the issue date scheduled for November 22nd. Tokenized bonds are exchanged digitally through a blockchain, with a debt security set to be sold in the form of digital tokens. Investors can place subscriptions with minimum denominations of 10 million pesos and increments of 1 million pesos thereafter. After. Qualified institutional investors must submit their bids to issue managers, including the Land Bank of the Philippines and the Development Bank of the Philippines, on Monday before 12:30 in the afternoon. Notice of awards will be provided not later than 2 p.m. of the same day. Now, the Philippine Central Bank left its key interest rate steady at 6.5% on Thursday as expected to allow the past hikes, including the 25 basis point off-cycle increase last month, to filter through to the economy amid moderating inflation and a recovering peso. But the BSP says it remains prepared to resume monetary policy tightening as necessary to steer inflation towards a target consistent path.
The Monetary Board noted that keeping the policy rate steady will allow previous policy interest rate adjustments, including the interest rate increase in October, to continue to work their way through the economy. Looking ahead, the Monetary Board continues to deem it necessary to keep monetary policy settings sufficiently tight until a sustained downtrend in inflation becomes fully evident and inflation expectations are firmly anchored. Key upside risks are associated with the potential impact of higher transport charges, electricity rates, and international oil prices, as well as of higher than expected minimum wage adjustments in areas outside the national capital region.
The central bank also lowered its forecast for the consumer price index until 2025, projecting it to be near the 2-4% target range by next year. But it does note inflation risks remain tilted to the upside. Now, for economist Yuben Paracuelles, the BSP is done with its rate hiking cycle. He also sees rate cuts happening by September of next year.
Where they will be hawkish is on the language. As we saw, the BSP needs to signal that they stand ready to resume hiking, because obviously if they pivot too early, and this is what the governor Eli is saying, that if you do that too early, I think the risk is inflation risk start to pick up again and inflation expectations start to be affected negatively. So you don't want, as a central banker, you don't want that to happen, because the job gets harder, right? So I think they'll be a bit more cautious when it comes to the pivot. And so again, it will be all about inflation and when it returns to the 2-4% target. Once it goes below 4% and BSP feels a bit more comfortable that it stays there and it's more well entrenched, then I think they can start cutting. So for me, that's in September 2024. And again, it will be a sort of a gradual cutting cycle to ensure that inflation stays within the target range.
The Philippine Charity Sweepstakes Office reports it earned an impressive 1.2 billion pesos in sales in just 2 weeks, specifically from November 1st to 14. That's an average of 87.6 million pesos of sales per day. It adds the sale of lottery tickets reached nearly 105 million pesos on November 14, marking its highest daily sales record since October. As of the third quarter of this year, PCSO sales already hit 44.9 billion pesos, on track to hit its annual target of 53.25 billion. The PCSO attributes this development to the public's continued support and participation in its lottery games. It vows to enhance transparency and credibility of the games. Philippine tourism earnings surging to over 404 billion pesos as of October this year. Now, this is nearly three times what it earned in the full year of 2022 already, as the country boosted recovery efforts post-COVID-19. The tourism department says tourism is the second biggest economic driver for the Philippine economy in the first half of this year. The industry contributed 6.2% to the GDP last year, with over 2.65 million foreign visitors and 102 million domestic trips recorded. The DOT says it's close to achieving its target international tourist arrivals of 4.8 million for this year, with arrivals currently at 4.6 million. Tourism Secretary Cristina Frasco shared the good news during the 2023 Philippine Economic Briefing, one of the Philippine delegation's activities on the sidelines of the APEC Summit. Meanwhile, President Marcos is set to bring home investment opportunities from the U.S. Marcos inked a $400 million deal with American firms aimed at providing internet satellites to remote areas in the Philippines. A $20 million U.S. FDA facility also set to be built in the country. Marcos says there is a need to ensure no one is left behind in pursuit of APEC's economic goals.
We can only be as strong as the weakest members of our economies, of our societies. Regardless of how much progress we make in these halls, if such does not translate to a better quality of life, about resiliency for all, we will remain derailed by even the most subtle of shocks and insecurities that are beyond our control.
World leaders attending the APEC summit in San Francisco pose for a family photo. Among them, U.S. President Joe Biden and his Chinese counterpart Xi Jinping, who just held a high-stakes summit on Wednesday. APEC members have been closely watching developments between the world's two largest economies and strategic rivals amid concerns more intense competition could upset global trade and security. The 21-member APEC accounts for about 62% of global GDP and almost half of global trade. Now, what is the benefit of getting rats high? Well, in Sweden, researchers have been feeding psychedelics to the rodents, hoping to unlock secrets of the human brain. Take a look.
Rats high on LSD and ketamine are helping scientists unlock mysteries of the brain.
It's the simplest experiment possible. We just give the drug and we compare the activity before drug and after drug.
Swedish researchers are exploring the effects of psychedelics and amphetamines on the rodent's brain activity in a bid to help cure depression and other neurological disorders in humans. For the last 7 years, researchers at Lund University have been testing psychedelic drugs on rats. Ketamine is a notorious party drug that is also a horse and cat tranquilizer, while LSD became the favored drug during the hippie movement in the 1960s. Using electrodes that are inserted into the rat's brain, the scientists monitor neuron activity as the animals perform basic activities, such as walking around an enclosure, and compare the brain activity to when they did the same exercise sober. Sebastian Barrientos Beza is part of the research team.
What we wanted to investigate here was to evaluate the commonalities of different psychedelic drugs, because lately this topic has gained lots of attention. And the therapeutic potentials are huge. However, little is known about the mechanisms, and we saw a great opportunity.
Researchers found synchronization in neurons in several different areas of the brain. This synchronization could be disturbing the normal way different parts of the brain communicate with one another, which scientists say could play a role in providing models for psychosis. Integrative neurophysiology researcher Pa Halj.
So one important aspect is of course to understand better the therapeutic mechanism of these drugs. Like why is it actually helping in depression, for example? Is it the synchronous activity that perhaps induces plasticity in brain networks that helps you get out of disease states? So that's one application. But the other one is just to understand better how consciousness might be generated in the brain in general.